You're not making a movie to please everybody. You're making a movie to sort of create a discussion.
In de VPRO Cinema Collectie praten we met gerenommeerde regisseurs over een doorbraakfilm die aansluitend wordt uitgezonden. Vandaag de Zwitser Marc Forster, die inmiddels grote films mag regisseren als James Bond's Quantum of Solace en het zombiespektakel World War Z, maar doorbrak met een kleine, intieme film. Het aangrijpende, raciale drama Monsters Ball.
It's interesting sitting now here with you because I haven't seen the film since the premiere. And it was actually an interesting story at the premiere because it premiered in 2001, in the fall, December or November 2001. And obviously in September 2001 was 9/11. So everybody at the premiere said, nobody will go and see this film, Mark, because everybody wanted to see positive stories about America, like happy stories. Nobody wanted to see a very dark, bleak movies where basically three of the main characters die in halfway through the movie. So you have a very dark movie being released right after the sort of September 11th, 2001, and everybody at premiere, literally without exception, said, bless you, Mark, you made a really good movie, but nobody will go and see it.
And but they did.
Yes, and somehow the movie happened to become a hit, and to the surprise of everyone.
You all right, Bethel?
Yeah, I'm all right.
You sure?
Yeah, it was loose.
Yeah. Did you see what you did, Sonny?
Yeah, I'm sorry. It was my mistake.
Yeah, it was.
It won't happen next time.
Let's just keep going. We'll get it right, huh?
In regard to casting, my wish was always Billy Bob Thornton. I always wanted him because I think he's one of the most brilliant actors in American cinema living today. He's just exceptional.
Can you explain why?
He's just, you know, what the interesting thing is, Billy Bob told me once a story. He was working for a catering business before he ever worked. And when he was working in this catering business, he was at a party once and he was catering. And a man came up to him and said, look, what do you do? And he said, Billy Bob said, I'm an actor. He said, look, you're not good looking enough to ever be a leading man, and you're not ugly enough to be a character actor. So what you should do, you should write your own script, put yourself in it, and that's how you will become a movie star, if you're any good.
Sling Blade.
And then he walked away, and a person came up to him and said, oh my God, what did Billy Wilder just tell you? I didn't want to cast Hallie because I felt she was, when I first met her, I thought she was too beautiful. I thought, you know, who doesn't want to sleep with Halle Berry? She's the perfect, you know, yeah. She's one of the most beautiful women in the world. And then I went to a location scout in Louisiana, in New Orleans, and I was going through this very pure neighborhood, and suddenly these two stunning girls come up out of this house, and they were very poor, but they were absolutely gorgeous. And I said, how can I judge someone who is poor that can't be beautiful? How silly.
Yeah, how, poor is ugly. No,
exactly.
Poor is poor.
Yes,
that's what it is.
Exactly, yeah. And how silly of me to take that point of view. And so I came back to Los Angeles, and Hallie was still passionate. I said, let's meet again. And I said, look, I want to do this with you because you have the most passion for this. But at the same time, I want to make sure the sex scene is one of the center scenes of the movie. and I want to make sure I can shoot it the way I want to shoot it. So what I will do, I will give you and Billy Bob final cut of that scene, but I can shoot it however I want. I will cut it, I will show it to you, and then if you're not comfortable with it, we have a conversation.
You know when you feel like you can't breathe? And you can't get out from inside yourself, you know, really.
Do you want to come inside?
Hallie knew it would be a very raw scene going in. How do you approach a scene like that?
We did like four different takes with four different lenses. That's it.
And no direction?
No, I mean, I gave them the direction of what I want to happen, like the body positions at the beginning. But once I told them that, we just went for it. And just, because you want them to get in the rawness. You don't want to talk anymore. You don't want the scene to be in your head. You want the scene to be here. The more you talk, the more it becomes theory again in their head. You want it raw and animalistic. And you want them to go for it and push that. You don't want to intellectualize the scene. That would be the wrong approach. So the key is to really keep it very animalistic and raw and desperate. And to get that, I felt the best would be to show them what to do, to say, let's do it, and then just push them in and just shoot. And when we change the mag, shoot again, and just have them go more and more, intensify the moment, instead of like, oh, Kato, let's talk about this.
Yeah.
And like, oh, maybe we should do this and this and this.
Maybe you should turn the shoulder a little bit.
You just want the rawness of the moment and want to push it and push it and push it and go to a certain place that they forget they're in a room. There's just, they see themselves and everything else.
And did they forget?
Yeah, they just went for it. I mean, they didn't have real sex, you know, both of
them.
There
are rumors on the internet that they did, right?
No, they didn't. They both at the time in married, obviously. Yeah, Billy Bob Thornton was married to Angelina Jolie, and Halle Berry was married to Eric Bana. So they both had were in relationships and married, but it was, you know, they didn't have sex for real. I was there.
Okay. Sort of became Halle's film. She won an Oscar. Were you there when she got the Oscar?
Yes, I was there. It was actually interesting. I was shooting Finding Neverland at the time in London, and she was shooting the Bond movie at the time. And I saw her. We had dinner together, and she asked me, are you going to Academy Awards? I said, no, I wasn't planning on, because we had two nominations, one for the writers and one for her. And I said, I'm not nominated, I'm gonna stay here. And she said, no, we did this together. You know, I have a one chance, one out of five to win, you should come. When I went to the Academy Awards, I had a driver. He picked me up, we're driving to the Academy Awards, and he asked me, what did you do? Why are you going? And I said, I'm directing this film called Monsters Ball. He said to me, oh, I didn't see it, but you know, it's interesting you telling me that, because he was from Hungary and he was Jewish. And he lives in the States, and he wanted to marry a girl who was black. Ah. And both families, her family and his family, said, we're not coming to the wedding. We're not approving this marriage. And he said the other day his mom went to see the movie, Monsters Ball, and she called him up and said, look, I saw this movie, Monsters Ball, and I think I'm starting to understand you a little bit. Can we have a conversation? He told me a story. We go into I'm going into the ceremony. Halle wins that year also, Denzel Washington wins. Sidney Poitier gives a speech. I come back out after the ceremony in the car, and he hugs me and he's in tears, and he said, you know, I told my mother when you went in, that I drove you. What a coincidence. She saw the movie, she wanted to have a conversation, and I told my wife and told her parents. And they all watched the Academy Awards, and they saw Halle's speech and Washington speech, and they all called me and said, let's end crying, let's have a wedding together, we all should be together, we all, you know, you both are our kids, you love each other, so we as parents should respect this and support this. And I came back and he like hugged me and was crying, and just that story alone, was it for me worth it to make the movie?